Love Bristol. Love BCFM.
Welcome back to BCFM's politics show, Friday Drive Time, with old Labour Oxford economist Martin Summers and me, Tony Gosling. Whoever's in charge of this ship, it's still going the wrong way. 1,000 years after the Norman invasion, is Britain still a feudal country? With the minimum price for a three-bedroom house in North London now topping £1 million and prices of property going up 10% in a month, it's becoming ever more difficult for us to get the one thing we really all need, a permanent and secure home. The average three-bedroom house actually costs around something like £50,000 in man-hours and materials to build. So why are we paying way over the odds to be housed? Land is a free gift to mankind, and we've got around 65 million acres of it here in Britain, with 65 million people going about their day walking around on top of it. So why can't everyone have at least enough land to live on, where they don't have to pay to rent to anyone? The fact is, some families make a killing by keeping it from us and have been doing so for centuries. So this week we've got two of the country's leading experts on land ownership, both of whom write occasionally for the London Press, including The Guardian, New Statesman, to discuss that very question. Is Britain still a feudal country? Cahill's a former Irish and British Army officer turned author and investigative journalist. He's the author of two of the most important books on land rights, Who Owns Britain and Who Owns the World. And it turns out the Queen features close up the top of both of them. Simon Fairlie is a farmer and author of Low Impact Development, which seeks to provide a route back to small-scale organic agriculture. He's also the editor of Britain's only periodical magazine about land rights, as far as I know, called The Land. So, gentlemen, first of all, Kevin, maybe first, why did you write Who Owns Britain?
Because I was assigned Old Wealth when I was doing the Sunday Times Rich List, and Old Wealth is land.
Okay, so what did you find? Did you find it difficult to figure out how much Old Wealth the various people on the Rich List had?
It was far, far more difficult than finding out how, you know, people with companies and things. There's no land registry for a start, which really stops you at the door.
So are you saying then, I mean, you seem to be implying maybe that the Rich List isn't really as complete as it should be, even now?
Without a land registry, it's fairly impossible to be specific, you know, to get it down to the last 100 or 1,000 acres for the big ones. I think Philip makes very intelligent guesses and is fairly close, but the basic tool is missing.
It's fascinating. So a big slice of people's wealth actually is hidden away.
Yep.
Simon Fairlie, why did you start the Land magazine? What was it that appealed to the land and land rights for you?
Well, the Land magazine actually came out of an earlier magazine called Chapter 7 News. And Chapter 7 was an organisation which was looking not so much at land rights as at the influence of the planning system upon the ability of people to build their own homes or to acquire accommodation that was affordable in the countryside.
And is that possible? Is it actually possible? I mean, to a certain extent, you've done it, haven't you?
It's possible, and it helps have something like Chapter 7 that's giving people advice on how to do it, but it's certainly not easy, and policy is basically directed against that. Though it is interesting that in the recent changes to planning policy that come in with a national planning policy framework, they have finally, at last, mentioned the word self-build in planning policy. It's the first time that it's been mentioned, and it's there, and there isn't there's a lot that's wrong with the new planning policy, but at least they are left a little chink open for self-build.
Now, land ownership is massively imbalanced, and we'll talk about some of the figures about like that in a minute. But what's your initial thoughts on this idea, though, of Britain still being feudal? It looks to me, as an outsider, as a non-landowner myself, that a vast proportion of the people don't own any land or very little, and there's a massive imbalance in land ownership. So it starts to look as if maybe that feudal class is still there. And some people, of course, have owned these massive, you know, estates for hundreds of years. Yeah, so what do you think? Is Britain still feudal?
There's elements of feudalism left. The vast bulk of Scotland is still owned feudally. And there are swathes of England, like large parts of Dorset, for example, that are still owned by feudal families. And all of this is listed in Kevin's book, Who Owns Britain. But it's certainly not as feudal as it was 100 years ago. Particularly after there was an attempt at land reform from the Liberal government, Lloyd George's Liberal government. They tried to bring in a land tax just before the First World War. They got stymied by the First World War. And then after it, the land tax got withdrawn, but they didn't bring in a number of taxation measures that pretty well hammered a lot of the less robust, bigger states. And something like a quarter of all England's land changed hands in the early 1920s. And that got rid of a lot of the bigger states, but by no means all of them. So you've got some areas where you've still got the Draxes and the Pembrokes and whoever, with these bigger states. You've got other areas where it's much more atomised. And what you're seeing in those other areas, I'm talking about the rural areas, is a bifurcation of land ownership. So whereas there were quite a lot of 100-acre family farms and so forth, these are disappearing because they're not economical. And when they get sold, they tend to get broken up. And so you've got a certain amount of fragmentation going on. And some of the land gets bought up by the neighbouring farmers that get bigger and bigger and bigger. And some of them get sold off in small parcels to people like me. So you've got fragmentation at one end, consolidation at the other, and a sort of a gradual disappearance of family farms in the middle. And that is the state of an awful lot of, I would say, the bulk of land pattern throughout the country, but not where you've got these bigger states that are sitting on land that they've had for 500 years. And as Kevin says, you don't even know how much they've got because they're not in the land registry. There is a land registry, but your land only gets put on it when it changes hands. And these great estates never change hands, so they never got onto the land registry.
Okay, on to you, Kevin. You obviously think that it is feudal. How do you evidence that? Because, I mean, there's actually quite a lot of people now who own their own homes. And if you go back a few hundred years, there weren't.
Yeah, no, there has been a striking change. But the key feudal principle was the ownership of all land by the sovereign. And he had rented it out to tenants in chief and so on. There was the rental connection. In those days, capital was land, and you rented it, and the king, you know, and all the way down. That's not changed at all. The crown is the owner of all land in this country. So the ultimate feudal principle hasn't changed at all.
But it doesn't actually make any difference, does it? If the Queen can take your house off you, the fact of the matter is she doesn't. I mean,
I think I've thought about that, but I think that's the wrong the wrong approach. It's, first of all, she's not likely to take much interest in the 25 million homes that are freehold. It doesn't work like that. But her managers, the country that is even more feudal than this one is Canada, where the government really enforce the Queen's rights, right through the system, not just the land, but through the system. And there it really does matter, because the Crown actively controls Canada. Here it's diffuse because lots of people have their own homes. But in the time of the Second Doomsday, 1872, 4.5% of the population owned some kind of land, a cottage, a farm or whatever, and the other 95% owned nothing. Now it's different. 65% of the population have a stake, but it's a stake in an interest in an estate in land. You don't own the land.
But we're still in a situation with 45% that don't actually own anything at all, aren't you? And, I mean, isn't it fair to say that with all this land around, I mean, you're one of the people that points out that there's actually quite a lot of land out there, that there's no reason why we should have that 45% of the population with nothing at all.
Well, I mean, you don't want to force home ownership on people who don't want it. There needs to be, you know, good local council rented accommodation and so on for people who don't want the burthen and, you know, the responsibilities. But the majority of the population have voted with their pocketbook for home ownership, 65%. So that leaves, no, 35%.
But most of those, surely, don't actually own the home. They are, the bank owns the home and they're just simply paying off a mortgage.
Again, 23% of all homes have no mortgage. You're not allowing enough time for a very significant event to occur, which is, it's mine. Okay. You know,
but 75,
goodbye Abbey National or, you know, the Halifax.
But 75% actually, who think people who are paying the mortgage, they have own their own home, they don't actually own it, do they?
Well, again, if you like, legally, they do. But the bank have a lien and it's another form of rental.
Simon,
25% may own their house outright and not have a mortgage, but if they sell it, it's quite likely that the buyer will have to get a mortgage again. And every time a house is sold and remortgaged, a whacking great percentage of the money that changes hands goes to the banks, basically. Yeah.
But it's still, I think, the lack of attention to home ownership by economists is staggering. They haven't even looked, never mind know what's going on. But there'll be a build-up all the same, Simon. I'm pretty certain one time it's going to be 50% of homes have no mortgage. That's the trend.
I wouldn't necessarily agree with you there, because particularly with this latest Help to Buy scheme, you're finding that people who are coming into the market have absolutely enormous mortgages, 95% mortgages, for example. And I would be surprised if within a few years' time you see a lot of change in the percentage of people who've actually managed to pay their mortgages off.
We see very few people realise that Margaret Thatcher brought the growth of home ownership to a halt. She was there to try and get the rented market going again for renters.
Well, she was selling off council houses, so how do you figure that?
Well, no, the sale of the council houses meant that new houses weren't built. There was a substitution instead of a new build. That was the first thing that happened, and about 50% of the construction industry went under. And they did nothing. They were the ones who were paying for the Tory party. And they did nothing when that happened. But the key thing, she was trying to stop the trend towards home ownership because it damaged the rentier concept of the market.
You mentioned this whole thing of the Queen actually owning all the land and you having freeholds off that. But do any countries around the world actually give complete title to their land, total ownership?
The United States. Yeah. And it's tricky to work it out, but I think France does and Switzerland. There are odd countries that do it, but the United States is the really obvious one.
Now, Simon, you want to say something?
But an awful lot of countries don't, and I can't see a massive difference between Canada, for example, which is entirely owned by the Queen, and China, which is entirely owned by the communist state. And that when you buy land in China, you effectively buy a lease. Unless the state actually intervenes, that's academic. And the Queen, you know, whenever I go and buy a bit of land or something, the Queen doesn't intervene. What is important with the Queen and the royal family is that they actually have private estates as well, you know. So the Duchy of Cornwall, what is it, 149,000 acres and so forth, and those are big landowners, just like the Duke of Westminster or the Duke of Northumberland. In that capacity, that's their private ownership. The rest is a kind of titular institutional ownership, which is irrelevant.
You know where it came into effect during the Second World War? 11 million acres were taken over by the military, and in a lot of cases no rent was paid on the grounds that the country was trying to defend itself, and the sovereign owned the land, so no rent. There was other; they were compensated in other ways, you know, repairs and all this sort of stuff. But there were instances where the military said no.
Now, you mentioned the duchy there, Simon. We've had a bit in the news about the duchy of Cornwall, 150,000 acres, did you say? The estate has been condemned over the non-disclosure of private property deals, including 38.4 million Waitrose warehouse. Serves as Prince Charles's Duchy of Cornwall owns the Waitrose's big national distribution depot. This was in The Independent on last Sunday. The Treasury has refused to provide details of property deals worth more than £100 million, which it's approved on behalf of Prince Charles and his Duchy of Cornwall estate, by insisting that the transactions are private and exempt from disclosure rules. Now, Kevin, this seems a bit strange, doesn't it? It's the Treasury that has to sign these off. The royal family is a part of the government. I mean, for example, control large things, a lot of things to do with the judiciary, the police and the military, for example. And yet we're being told that actually this is a private estate.
Again, there isn't... I don't believe it's a private estate. It's a public institution. But the law... The duchy is able to shape laws, so now it has the status of a private estate, except for the one court case where it's being challenged over the fishing rights. And this has surfaced. Have you ever spoken to John Angarick? He's been saying, you know, Cornwall's an independent state, etc., for years, and nobody listened to him. And Prince Charles... somebody said you're a public institution and you must provide certain services, and Prince Charles says, no, I'm a private estate. Well, in 1855, the duchy argued the opposite and won, and it's in the High Court documents that the duchy is a feudal state that is not part of the United Kingdom.
Well, let's hear from you, Simon. What do you make of this? Is Prince Charles a private landowner, or is it part of the government? Is it public or private land?
I wouldn't know. I haven't gone into it in the depth. Kevin,
but it was really
it owns a lot of land around me.
Is there anything? Is there any difference between a private individual landowner than or Prince Charles and the duchy that he uses to own it and manage it?
Well, I mean, my encounters with the duchy are him, for example, building a massive great estate outside Dorchester when I lived in Dorchester. The Poundbury estate. Which has some interesting architectural innovations, quite influential, but it's a bit bizarre as well. But then he was acting just like any other landowner. He had a deal with the council that it would come in on the basis of a ring road that was part of the A35, that was scheduled basically to be a motorway across the south of Britain, but never happened, you know. And he was doing just deals with the council and developers. But you say him, and it's actually, he's got loads of lackeys that I suspect he doesn't have much control of in some ways, you know. He battles quite a lot against his, a bit like the church commissioners, you know. You've got the church commissioners and who are basically breadheads, and you've got vicars, and they don't always see eye to eye, but the breadheads are the ones who sort of, you know, deal with the bottom line.
Well, it's very easy for him to say it's not my decision, it was the breadhead's decision.
He doesn't say that, but I suspect that's probably the case.
The contradiction over the Crown and Prince Charles is at a different level. The real contradiction there is the Prime Minister, the Deputy Minister, and all the other ministers have to declare their assets and their interests, and the Crown doesn't. And I think this is where we need some changes. Where the ruling person has interests, they should be listed.
Now, that is Cornwall and the Duchy of Cornwall. Kevin, tell us a bit about the Queen and her land holdings.
Well, again, people didn't seem to notice that the most important part of her personal, private landowning is the Crown Estate, 494,000 acres. And the new arrangements have effectively confirmed in law that the Crown Estate is her private possession. And that's a tad bigger than the duchy. And again, it won't be subject to inheritance tax or anything. All this. So you have the ruler of the country not having to conform to the rules that the elected prime ministers and others have to conform to.
Isn't it a bit strange that it's, I mean, what Kevin's saying, that it doesn't, that the Crown is somehow exempt from inheritance tax, which any other landowner would surely have to give up some of their estate, or when you know, they can't just pass it all on to the next generation when they die.
they found a way around that a long time ago. What's it called? Tenancy for life of a trust. The majority of the states, as Simon will have encountered this, the majority of the states that are left are perpetual. The, you know, heir lives in it for his or her lifetime. And when they die, nothing happens. The trust is still there. And some
so
new
the
tenant.
The trust is set up almost as if it's a person, an individual, you know.
But a perpetual, a person who lives forever.
That can't die and therefore can't ever pay in inheritance tax.
And the heirs and so on are tenants. Tenants for life is the concept.
But I mean, I live in a similar place. I live in a charitable trust, and which is an old Victorian pile that costs the earth to keep going, and it's got 10 acres attached to it. So it's not exactly a massive estate, but it's quite good to know that it's there in perpetuity and not susceptible to inheritance tax, because it provides a good place for loads of people to live.
Just give us also a snapshot, Kevin, because I know you've looked quite closely at this, at the Queen's land holdings in other parts of the world.
Well, in effect, the Queen is the legal owner of a sixth of the planet. As in, on the same basis, which she owns the United Kingdom. You know, the sovereign owns all the land. Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and almost 50% of Antarctica.
But practically, that's useless, isn't it? I mean, she's not doing anything with that. She's just allowing the people to carry on going about their day on that piece of land. She's not going to take over ownership.
No, but policy is created at Crown level. And in Canada, whatever policies the Crown hands down are executed by government officials on her behalf. Now, I don't know what happens to the money. I think it does wind up in Canadian government coffers, but I'm not sure. But nobody's ever, you know, forced the question. What about all this land and the forest you're renting in Canada? But the Chinese have studied the feudal system here very carefully. But the point to make about China, though, isn't it is a feudal state, exactly the same as ours. However, China has got more people out of poverty than any country ever in the whole history of humanity. India is still stuck. There's been no change. 80% of India is on $1 or $2 a day.
But is it a good idea to come out of poverty if you've got no free press and no freedom of speech?
Well, I think first of all, you have to be able to live before you start. But the thing about India is the landowner. China, the totalitarian government was able to hand out leases, was able to break up and get, you know, the rural China moving. In India, India will never make it, because you have tenancy agreements. They're going back 500 years with, you know, thousands of participants, and you can't get land to move at all.
I mean, going to the other end of the scale, over the last 30 years or so, Simon, we've seen the end of rights of gypsies and travellers. Used to be able to stop by the side of the road quite easily, and now they've been forced onto sites, basically. Yeah. I mean, into local authority sites. Does that matter? Has that changed anything?
Well, it certainly matters for gypsies and travellers, yes.
Simon, did you ever read Juliet Barclay Levy's stuff on the gypsies of the New Forest?
I have, years ago, yes.
Yeah, there is the tragedy of... Their way of life was different from ours. And putting them in campsites was... Their life revolved around being able to move around. And once you stopped that, you were effectively... That was the death...
I mean, if someone is a sort of living, breathing, farming person, I mean, how has that changed the rural life in Britain?
Well, it's partly that a lot of the work that they that gypsies and travellers did, which gave them a reason for moving around, has disappeared. And travellers are now involved in quite different things, like tarmac very often and things like that. But it's... they have lost the ability to park up anywhere and stay there on these trips. You know, there's a guy called Tony Thompson who's done an analysis of all the stopping places in Somerset, and he's produced a map showing these were all traditional travellers stopping places, and they've nearly all been shut off by either by private landlords or by the council.
I mean, in fact, if you go along quite a lot of our A roads in Wiltshire, Gloucestershire, Somerset, you'll find big verges which were, you know, actually there was a lot of grass there for animals, horses to have. Now, if you try and stop the night, you're likely to get a tap on the door from the police, aren't you?
This is bureaucracy gone mad. It was a way of life that wasn't convenient for us urban dwellers, and we let the bureaucrats destroy it. You know, the idea that because they were different, they should have been left alone never occurred to anybody. Are there any gypsies left in the New Forest?
Simon, self-sufficiency, that is to say using not a lot of money to grow food and eat a lot of the food you produce yourself, is great for the people doing it and also for the land. It's quite, you know, good ecologically, but it's no good for the economy. Is it under pressure at the moment? Small scale growing. For example, things like market gardens and the sort of stuff you're doing.
Yeah, well, it's... you're talking about two things. You're talking about self-sufficiency, which is most people who claim to be self-sufficient aren't. They're just growing their own veg and milking a goat or something. They're not producing their own Wellington boots. But there is something to be said for going back a bit closer to that kind of lifestyle. And there's a huge demand for it. On the other hand, you're talking about market gardens and so forth. There is a large increase in small-scale food production, basically to meet a demand for local food. You know, people are more and more interested in local food for a number of reasons, because it's more ecologically sound than transporting around, because you have more control over it and so forth. And it's local food is much more easily produced on a small scale by small scale producers selling directly than internationally traded food, obviously. And it comes back to this, what I was talking about, the bifurcation of land ownership.
This is going off in two different directions.
It's reflected in that the farms, the traditional family farms, are in the middle of about 100 acres, finding it very difficult to make money. The dairy farms have all gone. 95% of dairy farms have gone since the year I was born. So what you're getting at one end is big mega farms increasingly, and so you've had applications for £3,000 dairy farms and so forth. And at the other end, you've had a mushrooming of certainly in some parts of the country anyway, of small scale farms who are selling directly locally to the public, and they're processing their own food, they're making their own cheese or apple juice or whatever, and selling it directly. And that works. It's not easy. And a lot of people who try it don't succeed, but a proportion of people who try it do succeed. And so you can, it's in a way, it's easier to make a living off 10 acres than it is off 100 acres these days.
Why is that?
Because you, if you've got 100 acres, you've got more, say you've got 100 acres of dairy, you've got more milk than you can possibly process and sell locally. So you have to sell it to the milk mark, not the, you know, one of the milk processors at a halfpenny a litre, right? Whereas if you've got just half a dozen cows, and you've got a local milk round, or you're producing cheese or something like that, then instead of making half a p a litre on your milk, you're making 40-50p a litre on your milk.
Now, Kevin, I know you've made a suggestion earlier that you've actually got quite a lot of people compared historically who own their own property now, with or without the bank actually controlling their mortgage. What are your thoughts about whether that particular constituency across the country is articulating itself and actually engaging politically and getting changes that benefit themselves? In other words, so they can hold on to the bit of land, you know, maybe the semi-detached house and the garden that they've already got.
Yeah. No, when the great estates were formed in the feudal period, they made the laws, they dictated parliament, everything. The group that have actually, they're invisible. The group who've had no impact are homeowners. Three political parties have split them into, you know, the usual. And there's no party representing the interests of homeowners. None. You know, the division of the homeowning population by the party system is a catastrophe.
So what sort of power could they have if they were mobilised?
They could have the power to sack a government, and they could have the power, absolutely, 65% of the votes would normally determine who the government was. And, you know, when the Tories took away the... In America, your mortgage is tax-deductible. The Tories took this away here, and there was no rebellion. They should have been turfed out for good. And the homeowners just sat there and took it. And that had a serious effect on...
Well, why is that? Is that just simply because the debate's not happening?
Well, the debate's never happened.
Is that something you'd agree with, Simon?
Why should a mortgage be tax-deductible when rent isn't? Surely that's a bias towards homeowners. Yeah. If rent were tax-deductible as well, then I can see the argument. But
no, but do you remember the original purpose of the mortgage relief was to get private, you know, personal home ownership going. Mm-hmm. That was the whole idea. And there was this, I think it was a secret decision by the Thatcher government to bring that to an end. You know, and look what they did. They took that away and the building industry virtually collapsed. And we are supposed to need, what, 220,000 houses a year? And we're building around 100,000?
Okay,
so there's something wrong.
Yes, there certainly is something wrong. We'll talk about that in a minute, and also about rent seeking, this ability for people to get into the situation where they don't have to work for the rest of their life and their children don't have to work if they've got enough land. After, we hear from quite a famous singer about land, Woody Guthrie.
This land is your land, and this land is my land, from the California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, I saw above me that endless skyway, saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me. I roamed and rambled, and I followed my footsteps to the sparkling sands of her diamond deserts. All around me a voice was sounding, this land was made for you and me. When the sun comes shining, then I was strolling in the wheat fields waving and the dust clouds rolling. The voice was chanting as the fog was lifting, this land was made for you and me. This land is your land, and this land is my land, from California to the New York Island, from Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. When the sun comes shining, then I was strolling, and the wheat fields waving, and the dust clouds rolling, and the voice coming chanting, fog was lifting, this land was made for you and me.
Woody Guthrie there, this land is your land, and it's our land, most certainly. But the thing is it really? I mean, we've got 65 million acres. We were just chatting while the song was going on there. Nationalisation was something, Kevin, that was talked about, wasn't it, by the Labour government during the Second World War, at the end of the Second World War, but it never actually happened.
And it would have been incredibly easy. All you have to do is change the 1925 Land Act. Two lines would have done it. But as I was saying to Simon, I worry about bureaucracy. You know, there's a tendency in, if you like, socialism towards bureaucracy. You know, you give responsibility to the committee, the organisation of the state. But there's a tendency, the same tendency is present in capitalism, which nobody seems to look at. And with capitalism, it's far more dangerous because you could start getting people really controlling everything for the sake of money.
What about the idea of taxing land, Simon?
Yes, well, this is put forward by the Georges, the followers of Henry George, and there's quite a lot to be said to it, in my view. It's what the Georges say is that ultimately, and I think Martin's going to explain this probably some better than me, is that ultimately wealth ends up, all the surplus wealth ends up in the form of rent, which goes to the owners of land, and that this the owners of land obviously don't merit this. They come about their land by nefarious means if you go back far enough, or they've just inherited it, and they are in fact creaming off the profits and the benefits that actually should belong to society, and therefore they any owners of land should pay a rent to their land to the state, insofar as the state is represents all of us.
The trouble here, I have to point out, is that the state doesn't necessarily represent all of us. I mean, in principle, it might do. The idea is it's nice when it does, but it does all sorts of things that we don't necessarily want it to as well. Anyway, Martin, can I respond
to that? Yes, it does some things that we may not like Trident or whatever, but if you actually look at what the state does, by far the largest amount of state expenditure is on things like the national health system, pensions, and education. That's the lion's share of where our taxation goes, and most of us want that and use it. And at the moment, a lot of that taxation is coming off people's wage packets. It's coming off the buying of essential items, and it's basically it's pretty regressive. I.e., it focuses a lot on people who aren't massively rich, and it's missing out a whole load of wealthy people. It's missing out the people who've got all their money stashed in the Cayman Islands or wherever, and it's missing out the people who've got huge amounts of wealth in land, and they're creaming off the rent.
Well, I guess they're so powerful that they can put pressure on to make sure that things don't change. Martin, can you just give us a little explanation of what is this whole idea of rent seeking? Because this is one thing that seems to me quite important, that if you can actually maintain a position where you own something that everybody needs, you can then start charging them rent for it, and you don't have to work for the rest of your life. You can pass that on to your children. It doesn't really seem fair.
Well, this concept of rent seeking was originally developed by the economist David Ricardo, who was a stockbroker, and he was in favour of the repeal of the corn laws and free markets and so on. And in basic economic theory, wages are what labour gets, profit is what entrepreneurs or capitalists get, and rent is what landowners get. And of course, your capitalists and your workers actually do something to get what they get. The landowners, as Simon pointed out, they just inherit it. So it was seen as a clear target by people like Lloyd George and others. You know, we can cream this off, I think we should have nationalised land. We are now talking about land value taxation in the Labour Party, but it is being discussed as a means of financing local government and what have you. So in actual fact, in Britain as a whole, the only place where they still have rates on houses, basically based on property values, is in Northern Ireland. Because of course, in they brought in the council tax, the poll tax, and then the council tax here, but they never dared to do that in Northern Ireland because, you know, the idea of bailiffs going around taking people's televisions away just wasn't going to work on the Falls Road or the Shankill Road. It was not going to happen. So they've never managed to do it. And of course, the rates were what funded local government in this country from the time of Elizabeth I until Margaret Thatcher got rid of them. And that was because, and the wealthy classes always hated the rates. They've always hated them. They always moaned about them. If you read all your Victorian novels, they're all moaning about it, but they could never think of a better system. So the rates carried on until they were abolished. And now, of course, local government is really finding it very difficult to finance itself. The council tax is poll tax mark two. It's levied on people who can't afford to pay, who then have to be chased up, and then it's only about small amounts of money anyway. So much easier to tax a building than chase a multiple occupancy tenancy. But can I just turn the direction of the conversation around slightly? We were talking earlier about the third world and China and India. All over until quite recently, most people in the world still lived in rural areas. We got a majority urban population only in the last 2 or 3 years, I believe. Now, we'd be fools to carry on down this road of urbanising everybody. And in actual fact, in developing countries, it makes a lot of sense to stabilise traditional agriculture rather than get rid of it. And I was actually doing research at Glasgow University about Polish farmers who are actually very efficient, but they're a nuisance and they've got to be got rid of. This is not just a thing of let's go back to the past. If you look at dynamic Southeast Asian economies, the Asian tigers, Japan, Taiwan, China, South Korea, the first thing they did to build up to the modern export-led economies they are now is land reform. And at one stage, at the beginning of the 40s, the Americans were pushing land reform rather than opposing it. There was a guy called Wolf Ladyinsky, who was actually of Ukrainian origin, who was the guy who was behind the land reform in Japan and in South Korea. And of course, what you do if you have a land reform and you give land to the peasants is you've then got a reserve labour force which is stable, which you can then deploy into industry as you develop industry. And in China, they've got what they call township and village enterprises, which are rural industries located in the villages. And people work part time, like what they call worker peasants. They used to call them in France. So they're a bit of work on the land.
Surely, Martin, the point here is, if people have got somewhere else, they don't need to go and work in factories.
Well, but the point is, it changes the balance of power in the labour market. So people don't have to accept rubbish wages. They don't have to send their kids down mines or up chimneys. And that's the whole point. But we did it that way in this country. But that's not the way to do it. Well, what you should do is stabilise the rural population and then industrialise from there. And you can only do that in China. They didn't just take the land off the existing ruling class; they killed them all, millions of them. They made the peasants in a village beat to death the local kulak and made sure they all got blood on their hands. And that was the beginning of the capitalist miracle in China.
Well. Some miracle. Simon, I know when we were talking about the...
Can I just come back to something like that? Yeah, that's absolutely right about the Southeast Asian. But the one other thing that they employed was a certain amount of protectionism about their...
infant industries.
Infant industries and their agricultural industries as well, because it's no good doing land reform and dishing land out to people if they can't sell their produce.
In Japan, you cannot sell foreign rice in Japan. South Koreans turned up to a trade expo and they had a pack of their rice on the desk. The Japanese police confiscated it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Simon, we talked a little bit earlier on about this whole idea of the Attlee government at the end of the Second World War proposing getting rather close to nationalising land in Britain. What they decided to do was to nationalise the control of development and planning. What are your thoughts about how that planning has worked since World War II and what direction it should take now in order to enable the sort of development Martin's talking about, I suppose, that is more small-scale agriculture, people finding a way out from unemployment in the cities into small holdings and that kind of thing?
The 1947 Planning Act was actually basically pushed through by quite a small coterie of fairly bourgeois people who wanted to protect the countryside. Up until then, there really wasn't any much planning at all in the English countryside. It was called town planning, not town and country planning. And town planning was basically about sanitation in towns and so forth. And what caused the need for town and country planning was the arrival of the motor car, which meant suddenly that that people who lived in towns, people could basically commute. They could live somewhere else from where they worked. And this created ribbon development. It created a massive amount of jerry-building on the part of people who were better off. And at the same time, that you also had large numbers of working-class people who were who saw that the middle classes were getting out of the towns and creating metro land and so forth, and they thought, we want a bit of this too. So they were buying up bits of land that were subdivided up into little plots and buying their own little plots in the countryside. They were literally going out on the buses with planks and nails and building their own shacks in all over England, especially the south of England, in the 1930s, you got these plotlands of self-built shacks typically, I mean, for example, Basildon was built in Pitt, where Pitsea and Langdon were once, and these were massive, great, sprawling encampments of shacks of working class people who saw, well, the bourgeois going out to the countryside. We want a bit too. We want to be stuck in the towns. And initially, they started as kind of weekend retreats, and then they turned. You know, a lot of people use them as retirement homes or simply live there. And this was total anathema to, well, the Council for the Protection of Rural England in particular. and they had a big push to get this, what they call shackery, regulated. And then the whole thing died down during the war, though quite a lot of these areas got requisitioned for the war, so shore and beach, for example. And then after the war, very quickly, came in the 1947 Town and Country Planning Act, which basically brought in a development plans, full-scale development plans, for every district in England, and it gave the state the right to decide what you could do on your land or not. And when it was introduced, it was recognised that that this would up the price of the value of land, because it created a scarcity of building land. It would therefore up the price of housing land, and at the same time, so if your land was allocated land for housing, you suddenly got a huge windfall because the value of your land shot up. Whereas if your land wasn't allocated to building land, then you were a loser because you could no longer build on the land that you once could build on. This profit that accrued to building land was known as betterment, and the Labour government proposed that part of the initial 1947 Act was that if you gained from this massive increase in value because of being allowed to build housing on your land, that the state should take that value and redistribute it through taxation, rather than it going to the developer and the landowner.
So it's all come a very long way from people being able to build their own shacks before the war to after the war, and nowadays, I mean, the figures for actually buying houses are absolutely astronomical. We heard just last month that house prices in London leapt 10% in 1 month. And we'll come to you in a second, Kevin. But first, Marina Morris has been out on the streets of Bristol to ask you what you think of the current price of rent and whether you resent paying so much every month or every week for your rent or your mortgage.
Expensive.
Rents are very expensive because there's lots of landlords getting mortgages, and they didn't make mortgages available to the younger people these days. Back when I was younger, like my daughter's now nearly 21, she's got no chance of getting a mortgage, where at 20 I had a mortgage. She hasn't got the same chances that I had back in those days.
I guess it's, you know, it attracts a lot of business to the area, you know, in terms of being a city. But otherwise, I mean, certainly for student rents, it's very expensive what it is, but I guess just because, you know, there's a lot of demand for it anyway, so they can put up the rents just to make money. I've got to pay the rent tomorrow, actually, and I need to find £120 for that.
Yeah, they are. The house prices in Bristol in particular are very high at the moment. I'm struggling to pay my mortgage. As for rents, they seem to keep pace with mortgages at the moment, and it's putting a squeeze on everyone at the moment. Mortgages, it's just the banks trying to rip us off, basically, and get more and more for their money. And rents, I mean, it's the landlords are falling into the same category. Yeah, because everything's going up in price, and I've got to pay the mortgage, plus all the other bills. Energy bills are going up, food bills are massive. It's tight at the moment.
I guess a lack of available housing.
I think it's maybe that it's a good location here.
Yeah. Mortgages in Bristol, they are expensive because most of the banks are situated in Bristol.
I know, that's true, actually, because I moved 2 weeks ago from here and I paid £2,000 just to move for a house. It's not a mortgage, but it's a rent. Maybe because we're in England, things are more expensive here. But let's be honest, the money we earn is quite reasonable, so it's not too bad. If you work hard, you can play hard, isn't it?
How do we decrease housing costs and harm the 200,000 homeless?
Looking at the unemployed, within our area. We're keeping a lot of people in housing benefit within this area. They should be out doing either community service or those type of jobs, paying towards what they're getting out of society. Again, we both work. We work very hard, long hours, and still struggle where they, you know, they're at home enjoying being at home with their children. We never had that benefit. So if they did some sort of community work to pay back into what they're getting out of society, then that would help.
Best option probably, it's got to be some sort of, you know, high rise is the only way to fit them in, really, at, you know, the reasonable land costs. Equally, people don't want to see that, really, do they?
Well, there's a lot of properties that are just boarded up. They should be brought back in. Maybe the council should be compulsory purchasing them and then making them available for homeless. Increasing the housing costs, it's just a vicious circle with the banks at the moment, so that's down to the banks to stop money grabbing, basically.
Build more community housing, I guess. Force landlords to keep their house prices, well, the rent down. So rent capping, in effect.
UK is a country with loads of opportunities. People just don't take it because they don't want to. Loads of benefits, loads of help. In a way, I think they are too lazy to work to look for a job or something. Most of the homeless, they are British. They can't be bothered to work in restaurants, in cleaning. They just want, like, office jobs.
Is squatting justified?
It's not. Get off your backside and work like the rest of us, quite frankly. I've got to work. I've never been out of work since the age of 11. I've never not worked. I went back to work when she was 8 weeks old. I never had the excuse of I'm on maternity. I couldn't afford not to work, not unless I wanted to be some scum living off of benefits the rest of my life. I decided not to do that. I've got off my ass and I've worked. My kids are well adjusted for it.
I'd say no in most cases, but equally, you know, if there's a place that's, you know, you see is not being used at all, you should approach the owner and say, you know, can I have it? Or, you know, can I rent out a place in it? But
someone does own those properties. Certainly if it was my property, I would be very upset. I can understand the need for homeless to sometimes resort to this, but justified, no, they should be getting more help from the state and not have to resort to squatting.
Well, they got nowhere else to live and the place is empty, then I guess so. It's a last resort, isn't it? It's tricky, maybe.
In a way, it's not bad. At least the government is trying to do something for them. In a way, it's us, working workers, who are paying for it. So it's not fair, but there's nothing we can do, isn't it? Let's live and to help the other.
Well, that's Marina Morris's selection of your comments from Bristol about rent and housing. One thing I'd point to there is that in this whole business of squatting and homelessness, we've got something like 200,000 people in Britain who are homeless, I mean statutory homeless anyway, which means maybe either sleeping on someone's sofa in an overcrowded house or else possibly sleeping rough. That's a lot of people, 200,000. And just talking recently to someone who worked in public housing, a woman called Stella Clark, she was saying that when she finished working in the 1970s in public housing, there was actually no waiting list at all. So I'll ask you first, Kevin, how do we deal with this problem of 200,000 people with nowhere to live?
Well, first of all, apparently there are a million homes empty. There's a gap somewhere. Although I don't think that gap can be closed by bureaucratic measures, because I think it's individual.
Now, isn't this people who own a house as an investment rather than as somewhere to live?
No. A lot of the empty homes are homes in transit where people have died. But you posed a question about why house prices are shooting up. If we need 220,000 houses and we're building 100,000, I think that answers the question. It even makes land secondary. If there's demand and pressure, prices rise. You know, it's the way it works. But can we go back to LVT?
This is financial land tax.
Land value tax. The Financial Times a couple of weeks ago gave a whole page to land value tax. It was a ramble from the 19th century. There wasn't a single fact in it. A whole page of the paper and not a single fact. The paper failed to identify who would pay the tax. The people who will pay LVT as it's being pushed are homeowners. There isn't anybody else to pay it. So that kills it. And the other one, if you want to make LVT take over the role of taxation, the cost per household will be £21,000 a year. But, you know, the people proposing it never do the numbers. They never produce the figures.
Simon, we're running out of time a bit, but give us your thoughts on the 200,000 homeless. I mean, we heard some fairly cruel things there. They're homeless because they're lazy. But what are your thoughts? 200,000 people, how are we going to get them housed? In the 1970s, there was no waiting list.
Well, I'm all for squatting. It's a good way of exposing the fact that houses are empty and they shouldn't be, and it's one way of getting them back in. And in the 70s, it worked extremely well doing that. I question whether we need to build that many houses. There's a lot of opposition to building houses, not without reason. You've only got to go and look at the edge of towns and the way they're sprawling into the countryside and and onto valuable agricultural land and so forth to understand why there is also quite a lot of opposition to it. And insofar as there are a lot of, you know, large numbers of second homes, large numbers of office buildings that are being built for no apparent reason other than speculative ones, large amounts of otherwise empty property, you could easily house everybody just by converting all of this property and by putting a stringent tax on second homes.
Kevin, you make the point that there's a lot of land out there available. How do we choose which land
I think
to
I
use?
Would take Simon head on this. Sorry okay. about that, Simon. But
you better be quick. You've got about 30 seconds.
30% of British agricultural land isn't used at all. Only 6% of the United Kingdom is actually urban. All this stuff about the countryside being threatened is substantially rubbish.
It's not rubbish if you live there, because you see it encroaching. You see the towns encroaching into the countryside and taking people's communities all
the time. OK, we're going to have to leave it there, Simon. Thank you. That was Simon Fairlie, also who's editor of The Land magazine, and Kevin Cahill, author of Who Owns Britain. Time to sign off now. Up next is Cyrus the Virus. Thanks very much to our guest in the first hour, Labour councillor for Bedminster, Colin Smith. I'm Tony Gosling. We're online at thisweek.org.uk. Have a good weekend and don't let the banksters get you down.
Your mobile. BCFM is an award-winning community radio station for Bristol, bringing you national news on the hour. Live from the Sky News Centre.
From the Sky News Centre at 7, a Ukrainian student who murdered a Muslim pensioner and planted bombs near three mosques in the West Midlands has been